Well, we've been going through a four-part series on the important subject of worship. And if you remember a long time ago in the first message, we talked about the purpose of worship, which is to ascribe worth to God. And last week, Pastor Paul shared a wonderful message on the posture of worship from Psalm 63, shared some funny stories about, you know, how we can express our worship a little more each Sunday, maybe from here to here to here, who knows, right? And so, I love that. This morning, we're going to look at the power of worship and what God can do in us and through us as we encounter his presence in worship. And so if you have your Bibles, turn with me to John 4. We'll look at verses 16 through 24. And this is the word of the Lord for us. Jesus said to her, go call your husband and come here. The woman answered him, I have no husband. And Jesus said to her, you are right in saying, I have no husband. For you have had five husbands, and the one you now have is not your husband. What you have said is true. The woman said to him, sir, I perceive that you are a prophet. Our fathers worshiped on this mountain, but you say that in Jerusalem is the place where people ought to worship. Jesus said to her, woman, believe me, the hour is coming when neither on this mountain nor in Jerusalem will you worship the Father. You worship what you do not know. We worship what we know, for salvation is from the Jews. But the hour is coming and is now here when the true worshipers will worship the Father in spirit and truth. For the Father is seeking such people to worship him. God is spirit, and those who worship him must worship in spirit and truth. Amen. Well, as we look at this, the conversation that we just read actually comes from the last portion of a very well-known passage from the Gospel of John, where Jesus goes to a well in Samaria, and there he finds a stranger, a woman there in the middle of the day, which is unusual for a number of reasons. A lot of reasons why this is a very unusual situation. First of all, most people, most women in a town like this would go in the morning with other women to get water for the day and really to avoid the afternoon heat, as well as to socialize, right, and catch up with other people. And it would seem, at least, you know, when you know what's going on in her life, that she's trying to avoid seeing other people in the town, right? There's a clear avoidance here. The second thing that's unusual is that Jewish men of this time, and Jesus is a Jewish man, did not talk to women, especially strangers, out in public. It would be considered socially inappropriate, perhaps even taboo. Third, Jews and Samaritans did not interact on friendly terms usually, because there were some long-standing racial tensions between the two groups. Jews considered Samaritans to be a racial half-breed, to put it nicely, and also heretical, because they had a distorted practice of Judaism. The Samaritans only accepted the first five books of the Old Testament, the books that we call the Pentateuch, as being the only word of God, and they actually ignored the rest. The Psalms, the prophets were not part of their liturgy. And so looking at these factors actually helps us to understand the flow of the conversation better, because without it, it seems a little bit disjointed, but with it, you understand what's happening. And this woman, if you kind of follow this conversation, this woman is interested in the living water that Jesus has to offer, right? This offer of eternal life is something that she's interested, but it would have been highly inappropriate to carry on this conversation further without her husband being there. And so Jesus tells her the appropriate thing. Go and get your husband. I can't talk to you alone like this for much longer. Go and get your husband and come back. And it's at this point, right, that this conversation begins to turn, because Jesus catches her in what we'd call maybe a small white lie or a half-truth, depending on the way you look at it. Because she tells Jesus she has no husband, which is technically true, and Jesus admits to that. But Jesus also reveals that, in fact, she has had five husbands, and she is currently living with a man that she is not married to. And, you know, if something like this happened to you when you had just met a complete stranger, you'd probably wonder, who hacked into your social media or got into your emails, right? I think that would be, you know, my first thought. Oh, my God, someone, you know, has all of my information. But prior to the age of the internet, there would have been no way for a complete stranger to access this kind of information apart from the help of God, right? God is the ultimate social media, right? He is the internet, right? And therefore, right, she makes the conclusion that Jesus, well, he must be some kind of prophet, right? He must be a prophet. And so she immediately turns the conversation to worship. She knows that there's a difference in worship between the Samaritans and the Jews. And so here's a prophet who must be in the know. And so if this is a prophet, he must know a thing or two about worship. And she has some questions that needed answers too, like many of us. And in fact, she would be right. This is actually the clearest teaching on worship that is directly from Jesus in all of the scriptures. And we want to look at two important questions that need to be answered. And that's first, what does it mean to worship in spirit and in truth? Right, that's critical. Two, why is it so important to worship in this way? Why can't we worship whatever way we want? Why is it so important? Now, over the years, I think Christians have been split on the importance of experience versus truth. There's a camp of Christians who they value the intellectual pursuit of God and emphasize knowing the Bible, having correct doctrine over and against any sort of emotional or mystical experience of God. Now, there's also the flip side. There's an opposite group that considers those type of Christians to be too rigid, maybe too dogmatic, and they believe that worship should be free, spirit-led, and they don't mind, you know, some excessive emotions, maybe some, you know, expressions that many of us in this room might not be comfortable with, flag waving, right? Whatever it may be. Now, what is clear is this, right? Those are the two camps. What is clear is that Jesus, the apostles, and the early church did not consider experience and truth to be mutually exclusive, but rather they were meant to go hand in hand, strengthening both the mind and the heart, right? But this was what true worshipers actually need. And this leads us to the answer of what is worship in spirit and truth. And obviously a longer discussion than a 30-minute message, but the best short answer that I could give you this morning is that it's worship that is aligned with the Word of God and empowered by the Spirit of God. Aligned to the Word, but empowered by the Spirit. And worshiping in truth means that you worship, your worship, it cannot be thoughtless and without some understanding, at least a fullest understanding of God that you can possibly get. And, you know, as I mentioned, the Samaritans only believed in the first five books of the Old Testament, and as such, they had an incomplete view of God, especially on the coming Messiah and their own salvation, right? There's a huge gap in their understanding of God. And today, I understand that we all have copies of our own Bibles, the entire Bible, and most of us would say that we believe in the whole counsel of Scripture, or, of course, I don't think any of us would say it in that way. That's what, you know, a bunch of stuffy theologians would say, the whole counsel of Scripture. But you know what I'm saying, right? We assume, we believe that what we worship, how we worship, is based on the entirety of Scripture. But I think there's a question that we need to all ask ourselves. Are we truly worshiping the God who is revealed in the whole of Scripture, or are we taking parts of God that we prefer, that perhaps we're comfortable with, that may be a part of our religious tradition and fits our experiences? And I would offer to you that much of our worship, not much, but at least parts of our worship, some of our worship is based more on these factors than a clear reading of the Scriptures. Now, let me give you a case in point. Why do you close your eyes when you pray? Yeah. Is it in the Bible? If it is, I think you'd be hard-pressed, actually, to find it, right? And, you know, when the disciples asked Jesus, how then should we pray? Jesus didn't say, well, close your eyes and then pray our Father in heaven, right? He omitted something very important. Jesus, you omitted the closing your eyes part, right? But why do we pray, right, with our eyes closed? Well, Dallas Willard would tell us, right, that we pray with our eyes closed because back in the Victorian days, they asked their children to close their eyes to keep them from being unruly, right? To calm them down, right? And make sure that they were not distracted. It works for adults as well, right? Because there's some unruly adults as well, right? And we need a little peace in our lives, right? But largely, that's tradition-based, right? And so it's okay, actually, believe it or not, to pray with your eyes open. But you know what? You know, when I, you know, first became a Christian, I judged people who prayed with their eyes open, like, hard. Like, if I was praying, right, and I sneaked, like, open one eye, and I saw someone with their eyes open, first thing, judgment in my heart, man, not spiritual, right? They don't know, right? They don't know what they're worshiping, clearly, right? And don't we do that, right? We judge people based on our traditions, because there are many other groups of Christians that are, they're completely comfortable praying with their eyes open, actually. And it's fine. Maybe they're judging us for closing our eyes. They're unruly children, right? You know, how come they can't just focus on God? And, you know, worshiping in truth means that we really take a look at our practices, examine them, and to see where they may be coming from. Now, there's nothing wrong with praying with our eyes closed, obviously, right? But we can't say, you know, that comes from the scriptures. And generally, we don't really examine the way we worship, including myself, most of us in this room. And we kind of put ourselves on autopilot each Sunday. And we think these things are worship, when in fact, they may not be. And when I look at the scriptures, worship is a very specific activity in the Christian life. I think some people would say, well, everything we do can be considered worship. And I think that's actually a bunch of pious nonsense, right? Not everything that we do, you know, day to day is worship. For example, even though I use this as an example, prayer is not technically worship. It can lead to worship, but technically it is not worship. Listening to a sermon like this, though we call this a worship service, is not worship, but any good sermon should lead you to worship. Even singing songs alone is not worship, especially if you do it mechanically. And if you're just kind of going through the motions and singing the words, then it's just religious karaoke. That's all it is, right? At the end of the day. You know, I remember, you know, non-Christian walking into a room. And if you're a non-Christian, we're so thankful that you're here with us and exploring the faith. And, you know, this is nothing, you know, to make fun of you, but I thought it was funny, and so it's just an example. And, you know, I'm so grateful that you're here. But a non-Christian came in, and afterwards she came and spoke to me, and she said, you know what? I didn't know that there's live karaoke, right, at church. And I'm like, yeah, I guess this is kind of like that at times. Maybe it speaks to the quality of our worship at that time. It's gotten much better, right? But if it's not done in worship, in truth and in spirit, then that's all it is, right? It's live karaoke, right? And, you know, what's interesting, sometimes I think those of us who frequent the karaoke rooms, we put more spirit into that than what we do here, right? And so my challenge to you, right? What you do in the karaoke room, you have to match that level at least here, right? Do it at least, you know, to that degree. And, you know, the Greek word for worship, you know, just kind of bring it all back. The Greek word for worship is actually proskuneo, which means literally to bow down, right? And so the purpose of worship is to ascribe worth to God, right? But worship is completed when we respond in humility, when we bow our hearts and we bow our knees before him. That's the completion of worship. And Psalm 95, 6 through 7 says this, and you know, this is the whole shepherd theme. Oh, come, let us worship and bow down. Let us kneel before the Lord, our maker. For he is our God, and we are the people of his pasture and the sheep of his hand. The scriptures are good for many things, right? It strengthens our hearts and our souls. But what we see here in Psalm 95 is it is also meant to lead us into worship, right? Our knowledge of God that we see in the scriptures, the fact that he is our maker, that he is our shepherd, should lead us to this declaration, come, let us worship, right? Let us bow down before him. And I hope that's what's happening as we're memorizing or trying to memorize Psalm 23, that it's leading us into a place of worship, right? That day by day, as we think about these things, we're worshiping because, you know, God is our maker. And, you know, God's desire is that we worship him, right? Not only with this right knowledge, which is so important, but also that our worship would also come from the depths of our souls. That it would be a spirit-to-spirit connection. And the knowledge of God, as important as it is, has to do something in our hearts and in our souls. It has to lead us into the worship of God. And you know, Psalm 51:6, King David says this, you know, God, you delight in truth in the inward being, and you teach me wisdom in the secret heart. You know, that's God's delight, which is not only for us to know him with our minds, but that it would travel the great distance. That knowledge would travel the great distance to our hearts. It's been said, right, the greatest distance is the distance between the human mind and the human heart. And so our knowledge of him, in order for it to produce worship, has to travel all the way down into the depths of our soul. That knowledge has to come into our, as David says, into our inner being and into the secret places of our hearts, right? You know, places that maybe we don't even know. That's where it has to go into. And, you know, many great Christians have recognized the dangers of worshiping simply by God's truth, divorced of the Spirit. And some leaders that, you know, who are long gone, but who I really model and respect in terms of their ministry, have said some wonderful things about the importance of worshiping in truth and spirit. This is Jonathan Edwards, who is really the center point of the Great Awakening, the greatest revival in America, probably one of the great American theologians, if not the greatest American theologian. This is what he says about how we are to interact with God. There must be light in the understanding as well as an affective, fervent heart. Where there is heat without light, there can be nothing divine or heavenly in that heart. So on the other hand, where there is a kind of light without heat, a head stored with notions and speculations with a cold and unaffected heart, there can be nothing divine in that light. That knowledge is no true spiritual knowledge of divine things. Basically, what he's referring to is you can know everything about God, all the facts about him, but if it's not touched your heart, if it has not created fervency, heat, and affection within your heart, well, that's no true knowledge. You don't really know who God is. And conversely, right, if you have all of this zeal and passion, but you have no idea who God is, well, that passion isn't real either, right? It's, you know, artificial to some degree. Those two things have to go hand in hand. And in the same way, this is what John Owens, you know, the great Puritan theologian, perhaps the greatest of the Puritan theologians, he says this, in your thoughts of Christ, be very careful that they are conceived and directed according to the rule of the word, right? The word is so important. Lest you deceive your own souls and give up the conduct of your affections unto vain imaginations. Yet I must say that I had rather be among them who, in the acting of their love and affection unto Christ, do fall into some irregularities and excess in the manner of expressing it. And what Owens is talking about is this. If you're going to make a mistake, err on the side of a heart that is longing for God, that desires and has a zeal for God. He would rather have both, right? But he's actually talking from experience. Because, you know, the Puritans were known for their understanding of Scripture, but they often became very cold and unaffected in their lives, right? They only had knowledge. They didn't have zeal. And ultimately, John Owens said, no, right? You know, if there's a path that you want to take, well, err on this side first, and we can teach you these other ways. And, why? Why did these men emphasize, you know, this tenuous tension, this balance between the two? Well, they emphasized it because it's so important, right, that we worship this way, right? And I'll tell you why, right? And that's the second question. Why is it so important for us to worship in this way? Right? What is at stake in our worship? And I think what should not be lost on us is the fact that this Samaritan woman, what she immediately recognizes is that this strange man's supernatural knowledge of her life must come from the fact that he has some special access to God's power, right? That he's a prophet, and as a prophet, he knows about worship, and he must have access to God's power. And, you know, we've been saying that you become what you behold. And clearly, one of the attributes of God is that he is powerful and that we have access, to that power as we worship. And, you know, I am convinced in my study of the scriptures that worshiping God in spirit and truth is the key to unlocking the power of God in our lives. And I want you to consider some examples from the scriptures. 1 Samuel 10:5-6, this is what Samuel says to Saul before he becomes king. He's kind of a timid guy. He's not ready to be king. And this is what Samuel says to him. And there, as soon as you come to the city, you will meet a group of prophets coming down from the high place, the place of worship, with harp, tambourine, flute, and lyre before them, prophesying. Then the Spirit of the Lord will rush upon you, and you will prophesy with them and be turned into another man. And so here's King Saul, or Saul, before he became king, not ready, right, to undertake the role of king, the king of Israel. And Samuel says, enter into worship. Worship with these prophets as they come down. And the Spirit of the Lord will rush upon you, and you will be changed into another person, right? Person fit for the office. 2 Kings, very similar in chapter 3. The king of Israel actually asked for Elisha because he wants to selfishly hear a word from God, a prophecy. And so this is what Elisha says to the king, now bring me a musician. And when the musician played, the hand of the Lord came upon him, meaning Elisha, and he said, thus says the Lord, I will make this dry bed, steam bed full of pools, right? And so we see these two clear examples in the Old Testament of worship leading to the release of the power of God, the revelation of God. Acts 13:1-3 from the New Testament. Now there was in the church at Antioch prophets and teachers, Barnabas and the others. While they were worshiping the Lord and fasting, the Holy Spirit said, set apart for me Barnabas and Saul for the work to which I have called them. Right? And so what you see over and over again in the scriptures is that worship somehow opens us up and it makes us more sensitive to the voice of God and to his power. You know, as a church, I think we are beginning to understand, you know, Sunday by Sunday what it means to usher in the presence of God, to enjoy. This morning I felt God's presence here, right? And we're beginning to enjoy and understand it, that through our worship. But what we don't often realize is that the power of God is available in his presence as well. Amen. His power is available in his presence. And what I've discovered is that it's often in times of deep worship, both personal and corporate, where I can hear most clearly from God and sense his anointing on me and on the church. And, you know, it doesn't happen all the time. And I don't want you to, like, you know, get overhyped and say, you know, this is going to happen every Sunday. No, I'm preparing us for when it does. But when it does, I think we'll realize there's nothing like it on earth, right? When the power of God comes alongside his presence, there is nothing like it this side of heaven. And, you know, there is so much at stake in learning how to worship in spirit and in truth. Because in my experience, it opens us up to the power of the Holy Spirit and the extraordinary life that comes when we are filled by his Spirit. Matt Redman says this about worship and what we need to watch out for. Matt Redman, Heart of Worship, maybe a lot of the older songs, but this is what he says. Sometimes in the church, I worry that we've settled for goldfish bowl worship. We convey a tame and domesticated God and then find ourselves stuck in the endless pursuit of the ordinary. Right? Sometimes that's what happens in our worship. God becomes so ordinary, we limit him, and no wonder our lives become ordinary. But the call is to venture out into the ocean, to encounter the extraordinary, and to explore the mighty depths of God. And though our earthly gathered worship times may never sound the depths of his glory, beware of those that don't even attempt to do so, right? And I think that's the challenge before us, that Sunday by Sunday, at least we have to attempt it, right? We can't get mired in routine and ritual and religion. We need to attempt to sound the depths, as Matt Redman talks about, sound the depths of his glory so that through that encounter we may live the lives that he desires for us. And, you know, one of the verses in the Bible that we have to contend with as believers and really wrestle with is what Jesus says later in the Gospel of John. He says this, Truly, truly, I say to you, whoever believes in me will also do the works that I do. And greater works than these will he do, because I am going to the Father. And I think most of us here in this room, we might think, you know what, this doesn't apply to me, but it absolutely applies directly to each and every one of us who believes, right? Because this is what Jesus says, right? If we're going to take Scripture seriously, Jesus says, whoever believes in me, not just the apostles who believe in me, not just the pastors or leaders or the super spiritual that believe in me, he says, whoever believes in me will be able to do the works that I do and even greater. And, you know, I don't think it's coincidence that Jesus begins what appears to be this crazy, outlandish statement with a double repetition of truly, truly, or King James, verily, verily. It's almost like he's saying, I know that this will be hard for you to believe, maybe impossible for you to believe, but let me emphasize doubly how true it is, right? Don't let the enemy put doubts into you. And again, what I've realized is that this verse, unfortunately, it doesn't register in the life of many believers, not because it's untrue, but simply because it's been untried, right? It has not been tried, unfortunately. And especially, I think, here in the Bay Area, right, there's many ways to try to fix our lives, right? We have our resources, our finances. We have our technology. My God, we have AI, right? You know, what can't we do, right, with AI? I mean, there's, you know, limitless possibilities of what we can do with, you know, all these new things that we're finding. But it still remains, doesn't it, that there are some people who are sick and we don't know why. The doctors don't know why. They cannot be healed. We also run into people who are tormented, right, emotionally, psychologically. And the best psychologists and therapists, they can't do anything about it, right? And so there are things that our own resources cannot fix. And at that point, what will we rely on if not the power of God? Right? And that's kind of where we're at. And, you know, if you've tried, I realize some of us, we run into some failed attempts, and I am right there with you, right? Many, many failed attempts. I'll share one later on, but let me at least share some successes here. John Wimber, who was very influential in my life and in kind of my formation as a pastor, he was a pastor of the Vineyard who helped found or start the contemporary worship movement, but also he did help discover the American church, rediscover the power of God in the 70s and 80s, right? He understood that with the rediscovery of worship, there should be a rediscovery of God's power. And he described the ministry of Christ as power wrapped in love, right? I love that. That all that we do to minister to others, right, through the name of Christ, is power wrapped up in the love of God. And in the book, Surprised by the Power of the Holy Spirit, which me and Dr. Jeff are going through, and it's a book that I read a long, long time ago, and I'm glad I'm reading it again. Jack Deere, who is the author, he recounts a story where Wimber was leading a service, a worship service. And after, you know, they had worshiped, they sensed God's presence in that room. And he felt that God wanted to heal someone in the room. And so he said a few things that I think could have applied to anyone. He said, you know, right now, God wants to heal you. You're struggling with severe back pain. You went to the doctor a few days ago, but you haven't been healed, and God wants to heal you. You know, among a congregation that was probably older, right, that probably applies to like 25% of that group, right? You know, we all have some back pain, some issues that doctors can't fix, right? But, right, timid congregation, maybe like ours, right? So no one came down, right? And Jack Deere, who was a professor of theology at Dallas Theological Seminary, who didn't believe in these things, said, you know, poor John, right? He's making a fool of himself up there. He should have stopped when, you know, he was ahead. But Wimber, as he was known for, he pressed the issue. And he said, your name is Margaret. Your name is Margaret. And God wants you to come down now, and he wants to heal you. And in that moment, a woman walked down the aisle sheepishly because she'd been too timid. And if you could imagine, awe and conviction filled that room. Now, Jack Deere, who, as I said, didn't believe in these things, was a professor, one of those stuffy theologians, right? All head knowledge. He described himself as being disgusted and skeptical of the whole thing. And he assumed that Wimber had paid an actor, actually, to play that part. That she was Margaret here, but, you know, she'd be Shelley, right, down in Akron, Ohio, right, when they went there. You know, she'd be like Jennifer somewhere else, right? You know, they're just, you know, colluding to do this. But then a friend who he had known for 15 years, who was sitting next to him, said, "That's Margaret, my sister-in-law," right? Like, oh my goodness, right? What just happened, right? And the interesting thing is, not interesting, you know, I saw these things in person, right? Maybe not as dramatically as this, but I saw this type of ministry under the vineyard for years as the Holy Spirit worked powerfully. I don't know if we're under the same anointing. I pray that one day we will be, right? But during that special time in the church, I saw these things, right, many, many times. And, you know, what I just described is probably outside of the experience of many younger Christians. And yet, as we think about it, what Jack Deere experienced may not be exactly what we read in the Bible, but I think we can all agree that it's in the same realm. It's in the same spirit, right? In the realm of things that are possible through the power of God. And, you know, I remember in my first few years, you know, as a Christian, before my faith became a little more, I don't want to say institutionalized, but maybe a little more institutionalized, I attempted to do the things I read in the Bible. I thought, you know, this is what Christians do, right? You know, you do the things that you read about. And I took a lot of things for face value. Now, how I came to Christ actually played a big part in my approach to God and the scriptures, because my church at that time, my salvation, actually invited a guest speaker from Africa who was well known for his healing and prophetic ministry. And I was not a Christian at that time. And as he closed out a very simple gospel message, he started inviting people up to pray. And I saw the craziest things, people falling, crying, speaking and praying in tongues. And I sat in the back with the brother that I really respected for his knowledge of Christianity. And I looked over, and his arms were crossed, and he looked angry, right? He looked really, really upset. And, you know, you don't have to be a expert in church history to realize that there are subjects that different groups of Christians argue about all the time. And this happens to be one of the most hotly debated. But as a non-Christian, I was actually a little more intrigued, right? Like, oh, this is, like, interesting, right? It struck my curiosity a little bit, right? And I should have been more careful. So, you know, I got really intrigued. And so when someone came up to me and said, you know, I think you should go get prayer, I thought, okay, I'll do it, right? You know, nothing's going to happen to me. These guys, religious zealots, right? You know, they're all making this up. And so I walked down to the front, and what happened next really changed my life forever. As soon as this pastor from Africa started praying for me, and I joked that God had to send someone from all the way from Africa to save my soul, right? As soon as he started praying for me, I felt the undeniable presence of something powerful but incredibly loving. And I don't remember the exact sequence, but I swear I heard a voice somewhere deep inside me say, "I am your father." And next thing I know, I was on the floor weeping in the presence of God for the next hour or two. My wife will attest that these things are all true. It happened that evening. And I call this my Darth Vader moment with God because he's my father, right? Luke, Mark. And I realize, you know, in hindsight, why it required this power encounter for me to come to faith. Because over the years, I had built up what I considered to be an airtight, rational argument against the existence of God. It's a very simple, rudimentary argument. that you'll, if you're in Alpha, you'll learn about in Alpha. And the argument is simply, how can a loving God allow for so much suffering? And in particular, why would he allow so much suffering in my own young life at that time? And so in my mind, it was an airtight reason for not believing in God. But in that moment, as I experienced the love of God, all my opposition came crumbling down, all of it, right? You know, I thought, okay, I know now that there is a loving God, and he will one day answer all my questions, which he has, not all of them, but many of them. And ultimately, this is what is at stake, right? Not in the spectacular, and I pray that we don't do anything just for a show, because that is an abuse, right, of the good gifts that God has given us. But because God's love, the salvation of men and women, salvation of souls, the healing of the sick, those who are oppressed by their own, you know, spiritual demons, these things are ultimately at stake, right? And more than ever, the church today needs God's power and to say, Lord, we cannot do many of these things on our own. Not anymore, Lord. The world is too upside down, and we need your power in our lives. And will that happen today? I don't know. Right? I'm kind of afraid to try it, right? But step by step, you know, I believe our church can open ourselves up to the reality of God's power. Now, how do we get there? And I want to leave you with some just very simple applications to get this maybe out of the heavenlies back into our, back down here to what we're doing. I think, first of all, as we enter into worship, and this is from Tim Shepherd, who is a very seasoned worship leader from Gateway Church in Texas. He says, as you enter into worship, ask God to give you a greater sensitivity to his voice, right? Come in, ask God, Lord, let me hear your voice. Give me sensitivity to it. Second, stay in the Word of God by reading it regularly, meditating on it. Why? So you'll understand what God's voice sounds like, right, when you hear it. Because a lot of times you'll be wondering, is that me or is that God? But if you immerse yourself in the Word of God, you'll begin to discern, oh, that can't be from me. That sounds like, you know, what God would say. Third, begin to express your love to God outwardly in ways you have never done before. If it means bowing the knee, bow the knee. Right? If it means laying prostrate, do so. Maybe you're not comfortable here, do it in the privacy of your room, right? Do it somewhere, right? But let God see it at least, right? And we talked about how important posture is. And so do things that outwardly show, you know, that you're bowing down before the Lord. And finally, take your place in the church by fully engaging in corporate worship. As you worship, this is what he says, your enthusiasm and freedom will encourage others to also let their worship reflect God's greatness. And I think that's the power of corporate worship. You know, as we all begin to worship together in this way, and as he inhabits our praises with his presence, he begins to release his loving power into our lives because he cares for us and he is our shepherd. Amen? Amen. Why don't we pray? I ask the worship team to come up. Let's just pray these simple prayers, you know that Tim Shepherd gives us. Let's pray that we would have a greater sensitivity to God's voice. Let's commit ourselves to his word, right, so that we can discern what is from him. And let's ask God for the courage to express our love for him, right? And I figure, you know what, if you can't express your love for him here among, you know, all of your brothers and sisters, it's going to be incredibly difficult for you to express your love outside of the church, right? And so let's begin there. And you know, let's open up this time and this space in our hearts to the presence and the power of God. Let's pray. If you don't mind, we're going to extend worship a little bit longer today. You know, like sometimes, you know, so set on, you know, stopping at a certain point. But we really want to give God some space to work and to move. And, you know, when me and Dr. Jeff were going through that example that I shared in the book, both of us independently shared that, you know, we were moved to tears as we heard about this woman coming down, right? Why? Because it revealed the depth of God's love for her, right? That though she herself perhaps could not hear, God sent someone, right, that could hear for her, right? And I think that's some of us. There's layers of hurt and pain where we can't hear God for our own. And sometimes we need someone to pray alongside you, right? To open up the fact that, yes, God loves you. God cares for you. And, you know, if that's you today, I'm going to ask the prayer team if you guys can go to the side. And please receive some prayer today, right? Allow God to minister to you. Just receive of his love. And so, you know, let's enter into God's presence right now and allow him to do the work that only he can do, right? The Lord Jesus says, my Father is always at work, always, even when we don't necessarily see it or feel it. And so I'm going to ask the worship team to lead us into this time of worship with the song of invitation, an invitation for you to come to the heart of God. Posture you want to take, you know, feel free to do this. If you want to stand, please stand. If you want to sit and you just want to, you know, rest in his presence, do so. If you want to kneel, please kneel. Allow God's spirit, right, to dictate, you know, how you respond. And I was going to call him Pastor Victor, but Victor will lead us in.
Bring your sorrows and trade them for joy. from the ashes, new life is born. Jesus is calling. And oh, come to the altar, the Father's arms are open wide. Forgiveness was born with the precious blood of Jesus Christ. Oh, come to the altar.
Sense that I get and what the Lord is reminding me of is the story of the hemorrhagic woman in the Gospels. And for years she suffered with a malady that there was no answer for. Went to the doctors, the priests, no one knew what was going on. And maybe that's you today. Maybe you're suffering with something, whether it's physical, emotional, psychological, you don't know what's going on. You don't know if there's an answer or a solution or even a healing. And I believe what the Lord is saying to you in particular, those of you who've been long suffering with these things, reach out for the hem of Jesus, just like that woman. Reach out with all the strength that you can muster and grab the hem of Jesus and see if he won't heal you there, right? And if that's you, we'd love to pray for you after the service is done. But please come. Take a step of faith and reach out for that, because he loves you. He does. And he cares for you so much. Come, right? Not to this altar, but to the altar of Christ. Amen? Amen. I'm going to pray for you. Father, but I know there are some individuals, maybe just one, who's going through years of fighting, struggling with pain, internal or physical or both. And today, would you release healing, Lord God? Would you release the power of your Spirit, Lord, in your presence, so that the work of your healing, Lord God, would begin here, Lord God. And for the rest of us who, Lord, maybe that doesn't apply to us, Lord, help us to cultivate an atmosphere of worship that allows faith to rise up, Lord God. And as we close out this service with this last song, Lord God, may our worship, Lord God, cultivate and create, Lord God, that space for you to move in the hearts of those who need you so desperately. Amen. Why don't we stand together? We're going to close out with this last song.
Even when I don't feel it, you're working. You never stop, you never stop working. the darkness, my God, that is who you are.
Lord, this is who you are, Lord. You make a way when there seems to be no way, Lord. And Lord, as many, oh God, of your children, Lord, go through hardships, oh God, we pray that your light would shine a path for us, Lord God. Whether that's through healing, Lord God, whether that's, Lord, you just meeting us where we are, Lord God. We pray, Lord, that you, Lord God, would release, Lord, the power of your gospel, Lord God. That's what this is. The power of the gospel through your spirit, Lord. May that be active in us, Lord. The same power that raised Christ from the dead, Lord God, that lives in us today, Lord God. And Lord, we commit ourselves, Lord, to worshiping in such a way, Lord God, that that power is realized, Lord God, in each and every one of us. And now, may the love of the Father, the grace of the Lord Jesus Christ, and the power and the fellowship of the Holy Spirit with all God's people now and forever. And the people of God said, amen, amen. Give the Lord a clap offering. God bless you guys. If you would like to receive some prayer, we'll be on the side, and we'd love to pray with you. Thank you.